Welcome to the midnight taping of this marathon on Tisha B'Av, day of tragedies, day of difficulties, day of doom, and we're trying to give some a positive outlook to the whole situation, which isn't very easy, but we're trying. And keep in mind, we believe we're in a pit of levels, layers and levels, vibration and energy, okay? Layers and levels, vibration and energy. We feel we're in this pit, and we're trying to figure out how to be happy and joyful in this pit. And so we've figured out all sorts of laws and things that we can make this work for us, and we can get what we want, we can attract what we want, we can make, you know, fulfilling, wonderful experience here in this pit. But the truth is, there is no pit. There is no pit. There are no layers and levels. There is no vibrational essence. There's no energy and vibration. This is the belief, and there's a pit. But then you might say, "Whoa, what do I do?" Well, here's the difficulty that we all have. We all have this. Now, we're told, the ego tells us, you just have to, whatever you want, you should be attracted to you, whatever you want. Well, for me, I have no idea what I want. If you ask me, what would you want? I'd say, I don't have a clue. I don't have any desires for something. Not even what you call this life, or this world, or money, or success, nothing. I don't have any feeling that I need something. So it's pretty hard to concentrate on what do you want? I always, people say, well, I want this, I want to, you know. I don't have that. So the whole thing about law of attraction or something doesn't work for me, because there's nothing I want to attract. So what do you do in that situation? Well, what I'm realizing, there is no pit at all. I've never been here. No one's ever been here, actually. There's no here, so to speak. So I was reading Journey Beyond Words by Dr. Brent Haskell, which is, he transcribed it from Jesus. And Jesus actually addresses this whole modern age of law of attraction thing. He says, be very careful, there's this very subtle deception in attracting all this stuff, what you want, thinking you're the center of your life, that you can choose this and choose this, choose this, choose. He says, all of this is actually the ego. It's the ego. And you're still playing the game of separation, thinking that you know your thoughts, you know what you want, etc. So it's very plain that this is not it. What Jesus says is that when you have this experience, that has absolutely nothing to do with the past. Nothing whatsoever to do with it. He calls this the holy instant. Now, I had a holy instant experience just several days ago, where I just, for an instant, I experienced something. And I said, where did that come from? That has absolutely nothing to do with the past at all. No connection to time, thoughts, thinking, experiencing in the past, whatever, nothing at all. I just said, whoa. I said, I like it. This seems like, Jesus says, that's yourself. That's your true self. That is what you really are. Is you are not in any way defined by your past or your experiences. So that experience did come, and it just like, wait a minute, how did I get there? It didn't get there, you see. You're not in the pit. So we tend to go back into our past and this is a goal, I want to get there. You can't get there, because that's using the past. No matter what, I track this, I track that, this is going to help me get there. It's trying to use the past to get where? There's nowhere to get. There's nowhere to get. That's a path. You'll never experience yourself on the path. what we are is not connected to any path. Is not the result of any path whatsoever. So what do I really want? I really want to experience what I am. That's, I guess you could say that's the only thing I really want. Vision of oneness. You would say that's the only thing I really want, vision of oneness. Because how can you know what you really want if you don't know what you are, where you are? When we're saying I want to get to myself, you can never get to yourself. I don't want to get to myself. I want to experience myself. Not get to it, not reach it, not attain it, but to realize the self. I want to realize the self. And what is the self? They don't know. Jesus says it's not a separate, you're not a separate entity. You're not some me, some I, some who's creating a life for yourself. That's not what we are. Interesting. He says there's just the oneness. There's the oneness. It's beyond explanation, actually. It's a very tricky time in the world right now. Very, very tricky. I can see that. I can see we're in this sort of subtle deception, it seems like, where we're all encouraged to create our lives. And it seems like, of course, in miracles, they say that you create your own life. And I don't really feel that way so much. Don't really resonate with it's not quite like that, really. It doesn't matter. Everything is already perfect. So what are you trying to create? Happiness or something? Happiness is already the case when you see that nobody's in any pit of time and space and body and energy and vibration and everyone is one family of complete purity, of eternal life. I cannot explain how that plays out in this world at all, necessarily. But it's not a moth. But it doesn't seem to be play out as if you're some separate entity who is bringing prosperity and happiness and joy to yourself. It doesn't seem to be what's being talked about. So there's a lot of really weird stuff coming in the world, actually. A lot of saucer cults, a lot of Heaven's Gate type of cults, a lot of rapture cults, a lot of the intensity of the planet is going to become just unbelievable, actually. And the subtlety of this, what was being said here, is easy to overlook. We can't get home because we never left it. The idea that there's some way to get home, that itself is a deception. We have to stop thinking about a way, okay, a way, a means, like we have to master some sort of spiritual technology to get home. We never left. We never left. The idea that we have to get home is a statement that we left. So, is the universe a benevolent place or not? This training program is not a benevolent training program. It's designed to prepare us for something else. So I don't see the universe as being benevolent at all. That's why I don't try to ask the universe for anything. Because everything I've ever gotten had a very bad downside to it, actually. It was very dualistic. You see what you think you want initially, and then later on, there's the negative dualistic downside to it. You see, and then it drags you down. You say, whoa. You see that with wealthy people, the idea of prosperity consciousness, you know, attraction. I'm around a lot of super wealthy, successful people. None of them are happy. Okay, they're all obsessed with more. With more. They're obsessed with more. The more you get, the more you're obsessed with more. The more, you know, it's just, they're not spiritually happy at all, actually. They have just like virtually anything you could possibly want. They always want something else, and you think that makes them happy. No, they're never really happy. They're always thinking about, how do I manifest more? How do I attract more? That kind of thing. So I kind of want to, staying away from those people. I like to stay away from this mentality of this world. You know, just keep my distance from it, because there's a downside to it, a very bad downside that isn't highlighted. So if we experience ourselves as we really are, completely free of any past, the past has no relevance to whatsoever, well, that just shows you that the path has nothing to do with what we are. No path has anything to do, no spiritual technology, no practices, no techniques has anything to do with what we are. We can never practice what we are. So this is the burn that I'm talking about, is this: we can never practice what we are. And just to let that sink in. If you have the maturity to do that, you know, and then it's like, wow. But something within us has the courage to allow the presence of that thought, that idea. We can never practice what we are. We can never practice what we are. We can never rehearse what we are. We can never get to what we are. It's impossible. Because we're everywhere. And you cannot rehearse, practice everywhere. How can you practice everywhere, actually? Because it's somewhere practicing everywhere. It just reinforces somewhereness, you see? It just reinforces somewhereness. So the way is really to give up the way. The way is to give up the way. You cannot attract yourself. You cannot be attracted. The way is to give up the way, to give up the attraction, give up trying to be attracted to anything. And then the holy instant will arise where there's an experience which is not, and in no way is it related to anything that's ever come before, any practice you've ever done. So I see the real effectiveness coming from saying there is no effectiveness. It's a very amazing teaching, isn't it, so to speak, a way of looking at it, that effectiveness comes from realizing there is no effectiveness at all. And simply accepting that, and rather than cause a problem for us, it liberates us from the past entirely. and the future, which is an extension of the past, and even the present, which is the so-called effectiveness of the past, liberates us from all time, past, present, future. And not even liberates, but we realize it's not necessary. You see, this is the situation we're in. We think we need to be in it. We don't need to be in it. We invented this need. As I've said, reality doesn't need anything. So we realize we don't need time. We don't need it. It's not that we escape it, we don't need it. And then we realize that there's never been any time. We just, because we wanted to need it, we felt we needed it, we believed it must be. We interpreted it as if it were, but it's actually, there isn't any time at all. Nothing's ever happened. So we can also say, there is no way to succeed. There is no effectiveness at all. There isn't anything I can do. There isn't anything I can do. But of course, I don't need to do anything. I don't need to do anything. Saying there isn't anything I can do is a very positive statement. Because all doing is trying to get or establish or reach or attain or something. And that is what blinds us to to reality, which is non-attainable, non-findable, non-reachable, because there's nothing outside of it. Say reality, one way to just say something is the absolute stillness, but even beyond that, you know, the absolute stillness, freeness, and then like that, So we have to be careful about mastering anything. Who's doing the mastering? Who needs to master anything? Reality? What does reality need to master? So we can say, there's nothing I can do which is ever going to be effective. There's nothing I can do which can ever be effective. But the thing is, we can say this, and paradoxically, it is effective. And it's paradoxically, there's nothing I can do that'll ever be effective. And then you drop trying to be effective. Even beyond that, or not beyond it, beyond and not beyond it. So the question, how did I get here? We didn't get there. No one got there. We've always been there. There's nowhere to get. So the path never get there. at all. Paths are never effective. There isn't anything that's effective. Once we realize that, we don't need effectiveness in being what we are. We don't need to be effective. There's no way we can not be what we are. So we don't need any effectiveness. It's the ego that wants to be effective. It's the ego that wants to be the spiritual master. It's the ego that wants to be enlightened. It's the ego that wants to be happy. This is all the ego. What we are doesn't want anything, doesn't need anything to be, doesn't need anything at all, does not need any success or whatever. No. When I experienced this holy instant, it was like sky-like. Which is interesting, because that's what Longchenpa has said. The best way to point to it is our true nature is sky-like. I experienced this sky-likeness, and you cannot relate it to anything, any past. Any future, any time or anything, you cannot. Sky-like. But that's very clumsy as well. But I would say that was sort of a way to at least, you know, talk about it, refer to it. And we say, oh my gosh, it doesn't have anything to do with what I am. How do I get there? How do I get there? You stop trying to get there. Give up trying to get there. We don't need to get there. Nothing needs to get there. And the ego says, oh, I'll never get there. I'll never be enlightened. We don't need to be enlightened. There's nothing that needs to be enlightened. We continue this talk. It's not easy. It's not easy. But we're still continuing it. So nobody can be led to the self. It's not possible to lead anyone. All you can say is you cannot be led to the self. So really, teaching is really non-teaching. No teaching. As Bunjaji said, no teaching, no teacher, no student. No teacher, no teaching, no student. That's actually, you know, that's actually what needs to sink in. There's no teaching here, there's no teacher here, and there's no student. So coming to the place where there's no teaching, coming to the place where there's no teacher, coming to the place where there's not even a student, that's the place to be, as it were. That will put the burn on you then. That will really have this amazing how can you even describe it, but no teacher. You know, if you want to be, if effectiveness is the goal, really, in terms of dropping needs, all needs, no teaching, no teacher, no student. Come to where there is no teaching. Come to where there is no teacher. Come to where there is no student. Now that's an attention getter. when does anyone ever do that? They say, oh yeah, I have no teacher, I have no teaching, I know there's no student, and hold that presence of that, you know, that Punjaji said, that's the fastest, that's how you do it, that's how it's not done. I mean, that's how the need for anything to be done is dropped, the need for anything to happen is dropped. No teacher, no teaching, no student. That's why I refer to this situation, that I say I am the Jesus, free Jesus, so to speak. Not literally Jesus, but the Jesus, free Jesus, mean point to no teacher, no teaching, no teaching, no teacher, no student. And then it's not a surprise when there's an awareness, a holy instant of, you know, I am, all isness. Because you don't have any teaching or teacher or student there to tell you, to say what it's supposed to be, like what you've learned it to be, what you've taught, even taught it to be, and all of this, right? That's why Ramana was silent. No teacher, no teaching, no student. No teaching, no teacher, no student. People want to go to Ramana, I want to be a great teacher. But there's no teacher there. There's no teaching, no teacher, no student, really. Just say, who am I really? Who am I really? Who am I really? Not as a question, but as a statement. Who am I really? Who am I really? You see, we think we need this world to tell us what we are. We think we need success to tell us what we are. We think we need happiness to tell us what we are. We think we need to learn how to function in the universe to know what we are. No, don't need any of that. We don't need to know what we are. We are what we are. There's no need involved. This is why eventually those who have been working like this just, you know, the need falls away and there's nothing there to obscure it anymore. There's no need. I don't need to know myself. I don't need to know myself. I don't need, there's no need. Reality doesn't need to know itself. Reality doesn't need reality. It just is. But the ego, see, the ego can't understand this. It can't. It wants to do something. It wants to practice. It wants to get better at it. It wants to navigate its life. It wants to, you know, all this stuff. But we don't need. We don't need. There's no. We don't need to know. See, I don't need to know myself. I don't need to know myself. Because I am myself. There's no need. Reality's not saying, well, you really need to know yourself. No. Isness doesn't need to know isness. It doesn't need. Isness is. The reality is. All is. All is. No teacher, no teaching, no student. No teacher, no teaching, no student. Nothing to learn. No lessons to learn. No, there's no teaching. Hold this idea. There is no teaching. And just let that resonate. Just let it resonate. Past your intellect. Just let it resonate. There is no teaching. There is no teacher. There's no teaching. How can I be a teacher? There is no teacher. There is no teacher. And there is no student. There is no student. Just let this permeate. That's a good word. Just let these statements, declarations, affirmations, just let these permeate. Don't force it, but just let it permeate. There is no teaching. There is no teacher. There is no student. So we're doing more than just paying lip service to a nice slogan, no teaching, no teacher, no student. We're actually letting this permeate. No teaching, no student. Okay. There's no one to know the self. The self doesn't need to be known. The self cannot be known. It is. To be known implies a knower. There's no other. There's no knower of reality. There's just reality. Reality is. There's nothing to know it. So we say the self cannot be known. The self cannot be reached. The self cannot be attained. There's no teaching, there's no teachers, there's no student. Now, so the experience I'm having is like, this all feels easy, smooth, no problem, actually, right now. Just say, great, it's not a problem. Have the holy instant, the ego will say, well, how did I get there? And as soon as we entertain that, how did I get there? Then right back into delusion. There is no getting there. Nobody got there. There's no getting there. There's no there. Everywhere is not a there. How could you say, how did I get everywhere? How did I get everywhere? There's no I to everywhere. There's no getting to everywhere. How can you get to everywhere? You see, that's where the ego goes crazy. And when you have this experience all the instant, and you want to bring the ego into it, then the ego will pull you down, because the ego will say, I'm going to go crazy. You have to help me. You have to show me the path, how to do this, because right now I feel I'm going to go crazy. But here's the very important issue. The ego will always go crazy trying to get everywhere. How can you get everywhere? How can you arrive everywhere? So of course the ego views everywhere as all these locations. How can it do it all? You know, it sees it as total chaos, total mental chaos, trying to get everywhere. So always the ego will say, I really want to get there, but this is freaking me out, so can you help me out? You can teach me how? That's when you fall back into delusion. So you have to say, there is no teaching. There is no teacher, there is no teaching, there is no student. Rest in this. This is a very powerful declaration. Very powerful. Punjaji knew what he was talking about. And I'm sure he heard it from others, right? Too. There is no teacher. There is no teaching. There is no teacher. There is no student. And so when the holy instant arises and we are, you know, isness. This is. We don't turn to the ego and say, no, I need to teach the ego how to get here. Or the ego says, well, how do I get there? No, there's no teaching, no teacher, no student. There is no how do I get there-ness, okay? And we have to be able to not entertain the ego's request, because in trying to pull the ego there, then mental chaos will occur, and the ego will claim, oh, you see, now you got to teach me how to dispel this mental chaos so I can do this or something. It cannot be done. We can't get there. There's no getting there. So we're certainly, you know, the flavor is here. The flavor is here. I'm feeling the flavor is here. Don't have to struggle with it. The ego will say, well, if I'm not there, I must be separate. There's no there. See, there's no getting there. There's no one to get there. If there's no getting there, how could there be someone to get there, as it were? No. There isn't anything outside. There's no I outside of everywhere. So there is no ego that needs to get there. So somehow, this all seeps into us and permeates us, and the continuity fear gets evaporated more and more and more. It's all about evaporating this continuity fear, because this does seem like, wow, you know. But we're getting there, because we really got to the nitty gritty here of reaching there, and then what pulls us out, what pulls us back into all this struggle, is trying to help the ego get there. The ego says, well, how do I get there now? I see the goal, how do I get there? It's not a goal for the ego to reach. It's not a goal for the ego to reach. It's not a goal, there's no goal. It's the goal-free goal. It's totally free of any goal. Reality is not a goal to be reached. And so, but then you say, well, how can I be a teacher? Cannot. There is no teaching, no teacher, no student. This is a fact. So those who help here, suppose help, let me say maybe there's some help and assurances. There's no teaching, no teacher, and no student. This is what is helpful. And the more that this gets accepted, the easier it is then for everyone to drop the ego. I say, well, okay, it's okay. It's okay that there's no teacher, no teaching, no student. Doesn't need to be. Doesn't need to be any, you see. This is the great relief. This is the great relief. You don't have to teach anyone. The great relief is there's no teaching, no teacher, no student. You don't have to teach anyone anything. Now, why does some teachers seem to teach? Because people are so, the continuity fear is so intense that they have to at least pretend for a while that there's some teaching, some teacher, some student. But ultimately, you're coming to realize, no, there is no teaching, there is no teacher, there is no student at all. Reality is not something that can be taught. And therefore, God didn't create some student to learn about reality. again, rest in, we rest in the absolute, non-dual absolute, abide in that, we'll realize that I'm not a teacher. There's no teaching. I'm not a teacher. There's no students. We realize this. Of course, it's the ego that wants a teacher. It's just the ego, I need a master. I need a great teacher. The ego, you know, that's what the ego wants. But we realize there is no, I'm not a teacher. There's no nothing to teach. So, paradoxically, in this world, the ones we call teachers are the ones that say that there is nothing to teach. There is no therefore, there is no teacher. You don't need to teach anyone anything. You don't need to teach the ego. And this is the gospel of salvation. You don't need to teach. You don't need to be a teacher. That's the greatest relief ever, isn't it? That's the greatest relief ever. You just need to convey, to help people convey, you know, so they can get this, like, oh, I don't need to be a teacher either. No, they don't either. We think, well, how do we, you know, rescue the ones that are in the pit? Nobody's in the pit. No one's in the pit. No one's in the pit. It's just they're all, like, waiting for a teaching and a teacher. But when you tell them, you don't need a teacher. You don't need a teaching. Everything's perfect. If everything's already perfect, what do you need a teacher or a teaching for? So that then they come out of their spell, as it were. And they say, oh, yeah. So that's what really needs to be conveyed to all spirit. You don't need a teaching. You don't need a teacher. You don't need any student. You don't need to be a student. And this is what will actually, you know, the liberation, so to speak, the break the spell of waiting. Jesus said, the last will be first and the first will be last. Or the least, you know, the talking about how, well, the one that realizes that there is no teaching, there is no teacher, there is no student at all. So, that gets conveyed, then the relief is there, the relief is there. What a terrible thing to think you need to teach people, teach, you know, horrible, worst, the worst thing ever. What we are cannot be taught at all. There's no one to teach it to. There isn't anyone to teach it to. That's very important. In order for there to be a teacher, there has to be someone to teach it to. There is no one to teach it to. Everyone is already in reality, perfectly in reality. All is. No one's ever left. There's no pit. There's no trouble. So hearing this, for me, it resonates. No teacher, no teaching, no teacher, no student. I say, ah, that feels really, really, really good. That seems to bring relief, bring rain, as it were. It really brings rain. So realization of the self, realization of reality, you don't have to teach it. It's not something that's teachable. So there, you can just abide in it. You can abide it instead of saying, well, how in the world can I teach this? And no, there's no way to teach it. You cannot be taught. There's no one to teach it to. So, rest in that. And some will be able to hear this. It certainly takes a lot of maturity. There's no question about it. For me, I'm getting more and more comfortable with this. More and more comfortable feels, this feels really good. I've been getting that way more and more. No, there's no teacher, no teacher. Coming here, you're coming to no teacher, to no teaching. No studentness, no teacherness, no teaching, no studentness. Yeah, I was like, try that. What are you going to see? I'm going to see no teacher. What are they going to teach? No teaching, no teacher, and no student. End of the ego, right? there's nowhere for the ego there, is there? So that just, as Poonjaji said, just be quiet. No teaching, no student. Just be, sit there and be quiet. This is it, really. This is really it. That's the burn, because the ego is in search of a teacher. The ego is in search of a teaching. Okay, the ego is in search of being a great student. And if you go there, there's no teaching, no teacher, no student. You know, that just, you know, burns the ego up, and you just sit there quietly and not ask any questions. You know, that really just, you know, bonfire to the ego is just. Very interesting. Very, very interesting. The ego wants a grand teacher, a great teacher. You see, that's not it. That's what we want is no teacher, no teaching, no student. Now that doesn't mean that nobody's here. You know, there's no body, no person, or whatever. Now, of course, because we have a continuity problem, there's familiar props, but it's the presence of the situation, the non-glamorous presence of the situation, which the ego can't tolerate. And so what you do is you just stay in that, and the ego is just disintegrating. It's consuming itself, so to speak. It's dying, as it were. Let the ego die. Let the ego die. Because the ego say, there's nothing here for me. There's nothing here for me. I'm getting weaker and weaker and weaker. Nothing to feed on. Just let it weaken, the ego weaken, so to speak. But don't even think about it. It's nothing to think about. Just this ache. This is the ache. Just allow it. Wow, there's no teacher here. Who's your teacher? No teacher. Wait, what's your teaching? And no teaching. Oh, wow, how successful you've been a student. And no student. But actually engaged, it's not intellectually like some clever little saying, but let it permeate. The more we can accept this, the more the ego, we don't need the ego. Don't need the ego. The ego's only there because we think we need it. Because we think we need, right, all of this need. The reality has needs. We believe reality has needs. It does, we believe being has needs. It does not be, reality being does not have any needs whatsoever. Reality doesn't need to be reality. Reality doesn't need to be reality. So we don't need the ego. And the more we realize we don't need the ego, then, you know, it's just we no longer is needed. It's no longer there, so to speak. We're not experiencing the resistance anymore, feeling of a need. It evaporates. I think that's a good term, just evaporates. We don't kill the ego, extinguish it, or blow it. It just subtly evaporates and we don't even have to think about it. It just happens, it just evaporates. Our continuity fear evaporates. The more that evaporates, the less feeling we have a need. It's okay not to have any needs. And so it's okay not to need. This need complex, is the ego we call it, is really the belief in needs. It evaporates. And so I feel way more comfortable now with this than I did, a couple days ago. So this allowing this burn, this ache, just like, wow, no teacher, no student. Just like this, wow, it's just so. You go through that ordeal. You keep putting yourself through the ordeal. And then one day, you know, you can accept this permeates you. And it's like a piece of cake. Doesn't even cause any ache at all. Like that. It's amazing. It's amazing. Now, of course, the ego wants a teacher, and everybody's stuck on this idea of needs. So it may appear as though there's a teacher, and there's a teaching, etc. But the meta message is, within that context of familiarity, is no, there's no teacher, there's no teaching, there's no student. That's the fire that is consuming the ego, that underneath is burning there. And the ego keeps saying, I just don't quite get the teaching. I want to get it, you know. I need a better teacher. And so you let the ego burn up, as it were. You just let it dissipate. Let it evaporate. It evaporates. More and more and more it evaporates. But don't try to force it too much. Because, you know, you can force things too much if you try to be a spiritual athlete. Be a spiritual warrior, but not a spiritual athlete. Show off athlete, you know. Hey, I want to, you know, see how much I can do. Now just do as much as you can do. But this ache, this, you know, is really very intense, and it's an ordeal. Continuity fear is evaporating. The continuity fear is evaporating. The continuity fear is evaporating. As we just sit with this, you know, realization, no teaching, no teacher, no student, no needs. I don't have any needs. Don't have any needs, actually. Don't have any needs. There are no needs. And this is so different than what you're used to, what the ego wants. Dead again, it's just like the ego's just wanted to jump out of your skin, you know, just, I think I gotta get out of here. I'll never succeed here, you know, can't succeed here. And you just sit quietly, you just continue to sit quietly and still. Eventually, the ego doesn't want to hang around you anymore. It really is the continuity fear, though, that evaporates. And less and less and less need for any need. Less need for less need. Less and less need for less and less need. Okay, that's it. We've done the midnight taping on this marathon, which is necessary, actually. And there's a need. Well, we need to have less and realize less and less need, right? That's the practical need we have. We need to evaporate the continuity fear. That is the only need we have, right? Okay, very great. That's it for the marathon today.